really, really fabulous. I feel really good. It's like I walked into my own dream, you know. I had this idea of, I really wanted to do a dance record before I died. And I had this clock ticking in my ear, and I've been chasing the white rabbit down the maze, and I feel like I'm on the other side now, you know.
Gwen Stefani is one of the most exciting, talented, creative, diverse, fascinating icons of modern popular music and culture. A colossus of ceaseless invention and ambition, who manages to excel in whatever she does. A renowned vocalist, fashion designer, lust object, musician, actress, and feminist totem, she represents everything positive about modern femininity and sets new benchmarks for music and style. She eludes pigeonholing and eschews orthodoxies and bandwagons. In her own singular, distinctive, and unique way, she has shifted pop culture off its axis since emerging as lead singer of No Doubt in the early 1990s. With years of setting new standards in style and shifting millions of records worldwide behind her, she has a right to be recognized as a leader in her field, a high priestess of catchy, sophisticated pop and high glamour. Her music takes familiar retro sounds and reinvents them as feel-good, progressive, eclectic, slick anthems for a new century. Musically, she has matured and delved into rock and pop's back pages for inspiration, coming up with records that touch base with her core audience, but also move things on to the next level. She deftly weaves the best bits of 70s, 80s and 90s rock, pop, dance, electronica, hip-hop and R&B into her own inimitable package, twisting them into new dazzling shapes. Before becoming a fashion icon, she distinguished herself as an intense, astute songwriter of smart, sharp, 80s-influenced fare that tapped into universal emotions of adolescence and young adulthood. As she's grown up and moved on in other areas, her frame of reference has widened, and this is reflected in her recent output. With her solo album, she has had the relaxed self-assurance and savvy to cast her net further afield and enlist the myriad talents of esteemed collaborators to help push her sound into newer, more radical territories without sacrificing the beauty of the pop hook. Her blonde hair, belly piercing, and musical invention have become accepted as an integral part of the contemporary music and celebrity scene. From a nobody struggling on the local Californian live circuit to an all-conquering media powerhouse, she's traveled a long way and weathered the storms of tragedy, relationship fallout, record label indifference, and changes in musical fashion. She has remained determined, self-confident, single-minded, and focused throughout her rise to the top and takes nothing for granted. She's always willing to learn and absorb influences from other musicians and genres, never standing still and stagnating. Just mention her first name and everyone will know exactly who you're talking about. So much so that at times you forget her work in No Doubt. She's the fashion world's favorite rock star, whose dynamic debut solo album sold a mightily impressive 500,000 in just 2 weeks. A streetwise, super smart Cinderella who has turned her outrageous cavalier dress sense into her own label and become part of the Oscar success of Martin Scorsese's The Aviator. Gwen is the biggest American female rock star on US radio and MTV, having played and toured from the age of 18 in small clubs and theatres, and then graduating to amphitheatres and arenas. She is unique amongst her female contemporaries on American radio in having toured with that vigour and dedication, and moreover, she's the only woman who could just as easily tour alongside big hitters like Outkast, Green Day or U2. She possesses an instantly recognisable vocal style, a peerless fashion sense, and her impact on popular culture can be regarded as on a par with that of Madonna. She's benign, warm, open, and accessible on the one hand, but also tough and direct when she wants to be. She takes no prisoners and refuses to dumb down her presentation to make herself more palatable. When it comes to clothes, she exudes confidence, sex, and originality, effortlessly combining designer style and edgy punk trimmings to make for inspired, daring juxtapositions. She is her own woman, creating her own alternative aesthetic with nods both towards street and high fashion, punk and new wave. There is simply no one else like her on the current scene. She easily attracts admirers, wannabes and hangers-on, but remains resolutely unaffected by the transience of Flavour of the Month associations. For all her high-profile visibility in public life, she is doggedly serious about her music, slaving like a perfectionist over matters of taste, arrangement, production and tempo. She aims to express herself as lucidly and honestly as is possible, exposing her vulnerability and naked desires to all her listeners. There is poetry, candor, grace, and sensitivity in her soul. She soars like an angel and can only get better as she matures as a woman and an artist. This multi-dimensional creative volcano oozes sexual allure and a razor-sharp intelligence. She simply has star quality.
To like, you know, I don't have to like play by the fashion rules because I don't know them, and I don't have to like try to sell to my audience or try to target an audience or have a certain price point. You know, I just wanted to make clothes for myself that I would wear, and have all my dreams come true.
Gwendolyn Renee Stefani was born on the 3rd of October, 1969, in Anaheim, California, and was raised in Southern California along with siblings Eric, Todd and Jill by their musically minded parents. Gwen seemed destined for musical immortality from day one, for this daughter of folk musician parents spent her childhood watching The Sound of Music and performing her own mini musicals with her sister and friends. Her earliest memory is of her and brother Eric stealing Oreos from the family kitchen, scraping out all the white stuff and making a big ball out of it. She was very much a girly girl, playing with baby dolls, playing house, and dressing up in costumes. Her big brother Eric was always drawing cartoons and doodles of Gwen and hitting the piano keys like a madman every morning. He clearly had talent, and Gwen was his little toy. As she got older, it would be Eric who encouraged her to sing. Her father, Dennis, was Italian, and her mother, Patty, was of Irish and Scottish descent. They met at Anaheim High School and clicked through a shared love of music, particularly folk and bluegrass. Patty quit her job as a dental assistant in order to stay at home with the children, as they both wanted nothing more than to produce four offspring. Dennis had been a marketing executive for Yamaha and worked with bands. He was in a folk group with Patty called the Inner Tubes, where he played guitar and she played auto harp. They were both enormously enthusiastic about American roots music, and there were a lot of bluegrass, folk and country records in the Stefani house, along with an abundance of classic Bob Dylan. They both took Gwen to various bluegrass and folk festivals, though she remained indifferent to those forms of music. These experiences did, however, subconsciously help to instill a musical appreciation and expression in their daughter. Instead of delicate strumming and hippie sentiments, Gwen was drawn towards the glitz, camp and pure theatre of show tunes. She fell in love with the likes of Annie, The Sound of Music, Evita and Kermit the Frog's Rainbow Connection. She began performing at family gatherings during her childhood in Orange County and put on mini revues and musicals with her equally prodigious and precocious school friends. Her Catholic parents were very supportive of all her musical and performing enthusiasms, but they were also very protective of her. Her grandmother was obese, and this resulted in Patty putting her slightly chubby, diffident daughter onto a strict diet by the time she reached 12 years old. This classic daddy's girl was a keen sportswoman, competing in soccer, water ballet, and other pursuits. She played piccolo in the marching band at school and was always going for musical and dramatic auditions. She even developed a taste for fashion at an early age and began making her own clothes. When it came to school, she hated studying maths and was generally a rather passive, indolent pupil. She experienced trouble with her grades at Laura High School, but managed to reach Cypress College for further study. Unlike many girls of her age, she never had any extracurricular problems with boys, drugs, alcohol, or lawlessness. Through her dad's line of work, she was able to meet Sting and the 80s band A Flock of Seagulls, which helped turn her on to music. Dennis and Patty were highly moral parents, and before Gwen saw the film Flashdance, they even lectured all their children about the protagonist's sexual mores. For her graduation, she had to go to Disneyland instead of the usual hotel parties, and had to be home by midnight. Even at the age of 21, during a family vacation in Italy, she was asked to obey strict rules, namely, ignoring any advances from boys and wearing only long dresses with her shoulders covered up. Despite this, Gwen wasn't one to break these boundaries and kick against her parents' norms and values. She respected them and didn't go off the rails. She actually couldn't believe that some of her school friends hated their parents with a passion and were in perpetual conflict with them. Hers never did anything so unreasonable that she had to resort to hurling cuss words at them like some other girls. Later in life, though, she did use the F word once, to her mother's horror, at a concert attended by Patty and a friend of hers. The resulting week-long silence signified that Patty wasn't best pleased. As she hit her teens, she became more and more interested in music and loved the ska scene in California. Her life took an important new direction when she heard an album by 80s ska revivalists, Madness, and she never looked back. The hybrid sound of ska and punk made its presence felt in the Southern Californian area, and she knew she had to be part of this. In 1987, her gifted brother Eric formed a group called No Doubt with his friend John Spence, and soon they recruited Gwen to perform vocals alongside Spence. Bassist Tony Canal joined sometime later, and this ska punk pop outfit began gigging locally wherever they could. Soon, they were a popular attraction at school and college parties, and started gaining a cult following. However, by the end of the year, Spence, the group's charismatic singer, committed suicide, and the band was thrown into disarray. After questioning their musical ambitions, they decided to carry on to honour his memory, and Gwen made the move up to lead vocalist. This was quite scary for a teenage girl still at college, but she grabbed her opportunity and took her new responsibilities very seriously. The first couple of years were tough and would have tested the resolve of many up-and-coming artists. Graduating from high school, she followed her studies through to the California State Fullerton College, where she juggled her education with her musical activities and a burgeoning relationship with new band member Tony Canal. In 1989, No Doubt were fleshed out by the addition of guitarist Tom Dumont and drummer Adrian Young, and it was obvious that they were on a serious mission to make a success of themselves. Their prowess as a live act was becoming more and more polished, and Gwen's confidence as a performer was soaring, thanks in no small part to her growing awareness of her sexual allure. Her relationship with Canal was cemented through his love of Prince, Wendy and Lisa, and Debbie Deb. He turned Gwen on to these artists and encouraged her to chase her musical dreams. When he auditioned for the band, he was wearing white baggy pants, Jesus sandals, and his hair was wild and messed up. He wooed her with his musical knowledge and dark sense of humour, and an 8-year relationship was forged. No Doubt were committed to honing their act and writing as much original material as they could come up with. Despite the initial years of industry indifference, struggle and disappointment, No Doubt never lost faith and kept persevering. There was a steeliness of resolve within Gwen and her cohorts that would yield to no one or nothing.
It's weird because before high school, you know, that's when I was like this little chubby girl that nobody wanted to let kiss. Aww. And then when I got into high school, I think that I kind of started growing and, like, you know, you kind of start blossoming a little bit. My band has been my best friends for this whole time, and they're still my friends.
In 1990, No Doubt got their first major break when Flea of Red Hot Chili Peppers got wind of their musical promise and liked what he heard. He recorded a demo of the group's best tracks and introduced them to the Interscope label. They were suitably impressed and signed Gwen and Co. to their roster of talent. No Doubt were up and running. 2 years later, the debut album was unleashed for public consumption. Released in March of that year, it was an excellent, inspiring, powerful first set from an act clearly destined for bigger things in the future. Recorded for less than $13,000, the album was dedicated to the memory of Spence and featured a smorgasbord of bouncy, jittery, ska, and new wave-influenced pop. Included on this 14-song collection are gems such as Move On, Sometimes, Sinking, Doormat, Sad For Me, and Let's Get Back. Each track fizzes with energy, radiating joy, urgency, and angst in equal measure. There is little that is groundbreaking or thrillingly original on offer here, but No Doubt display an astute awareness of the killer potential of the nagging pop hook. The musicianship, aided and abetted by a punchy horn section, is solid and betrays an obsessive knowledge of the jubilant ska pop of the late 70s and early 80s, as typified by The Specials, Madness and Selector. The song, Trapped in a Box, was issued as the first single from the record, featuring a promo video clip recorded in the summer of 1992 that cost $5,000 to make. It never got played on MTV though, and so got lost in the morass of record releases. Eric did also make a video for Big City Train, but this was only distributed to a small number of friends and industry people and didn't get a wider release. Despite positive reviews in the press, local radio were unmoved, with the LA station K-Rock even commenting that it would take some form of divine intervention to get this band on the radio. However, this album has a charming, naive, accessible quality that sets it apart from a lot of the intense, grinding grunge music of the period. Compared to Southern California's staple ska punk fusion sound, it is relatively pop-orientated, with punchy brass and new wave keyboards proving a perfectly judged foil for Gwen's ballsy, soaring vocals and the loping ska rhythms. This same year, No Doubt played their first non-Californian dates and embarked upon their first 13-show, two-week tour. But still, the industry wasn't listening. No Doubt's uplifting ska beats and bouncy choruses were deemed as uncool in an era where the harsh metallic rage of Nirvana, Pearl Jam and their ilk exerted a firm stranglehold over listening habits and musical fashion. It only sold 30,000 copies and was regarded as a flop by Interscope, who strangely did very little to promote their young bucks, so much so that for Gwen it felt like she and her colleagues were doing everything themselves to finance and promote their product. The only support for the album came when they toured. Radio airplay was scattered and mostly confined to college radio networks. No Doubt were disappointed and frustrated by Interscope's inertia and indifference, and got back from touring with a batch of new songs ready to record for the label. Interscope, though, regarded the debut as an expensive failure and intimated that they'd prefer No Doubt to concentrate on writing as opposed to recording. Armed with bags of self-belief and an innate desire to succeed, No Doubt then made a very brave move, which was to pay off handsomely.
Meanwhile, I'm in this band, and then what happened? And then I started making clothes for it to go on tour. I didn't have any money, you know. We were on the Tragic Kingdom tour. I didn't have anything except for my makeup and my suitcase.
No Doubt were eager to seize the moment and refused to be browbeaten by their label, so they went and did the unthinkable. They released their next album off their own back. They put up money of their own in 1995 to release The Beacon Street Collection, an official bootleg of tracks recorded between 1992 and early 1995. They were very frustrated with their situation, so they acted to counter Interscope's intransigence and sniffy attitude to the sales of the debut. They'd been making these tracks in garages for the previous 3 years and had dreamed of putting them all onto one CD, which they did without their label's assistance, financial or otherwise. It was a moment of empowerment and liberation for Gwen and the boys. The Beacon Street Collection is a remarkable canon of work, featuring 10 glorious slabs of Good Time No Doubt, ranging from Open the Gate and Greener Pastures, through to Snakes, Total Hate 95 and Doghouse. There is less polish here than on the debut album, instead opting for a rawer, more visceral feel in tune with the grunge style. On this album, their sound is a cunning amalgam of rock, hardcore, grunge, and their own quirky assimilation of ska. Gwen's guttural voice reaches a new plateau, and the tasteful brass and playful melodies weave their insidious magic inside your brain, seemingly with little effort at all. Here is the sound of a group of musicians cutting loose, defining their style with grace, urgency, and raw energy. It represents the triumph of a group whose label refused to release them from their contract, but weren't going to give them the time of day. This is their retort, delivered with stunning eloquence and vision. Critics were quick to praise this audacious release, commending the band's willingness to join the dots between different musical styles with a flair and confidence redolent of more established names in rock and pop. This helped reignite Interscope's interest in their charges and introduced the No Doubt gospel to a wider audience. Meanwhile, they were working on new songs, playing live shows and building a studio in a garage on Beacon Street Avenue in Anaheim. Gwen and Tony split up after 8 years together, and she began writing songs about the breakup, turning the song Don't Speak into tortured love song gold. Gwen left the band for a short while, but returned with more vigour and determination than ever. Despite the plaudits generated by their self-financed sophomore disc, there was a growing feeling that the next release on Interscope would have to take them to the next level. Gwen wasn't looking for a new relationship so soon after Tony, but in February 1996, she met Gavin Rossdale of Bush, and they clicked. No Doubt's leg of the tour was supposed to last just 3 weeks, but it was extended to 3 months. By the third day of the tour, Gwen knew that Gavin was the one for her, the true love of her life. He was charming, funny, and romantic, and they both fell passionately in love with each other. The last thing she wanted was a relationship with another musician, but she had to go with her heart. Of course, a series of industry rumours began to circulate about their low-profile relationship, from them being engaged, being married, and even that they were having a love child.
Into like being like my little ska girl skirts, and I would peg everything, and I had everything pegged like this tight and like I would get Levi's and peg them like that tight, but it was just like all about like sewing and projects in my room, and nobody was, you know, nobody could come in there because it was dangerous with all the pins and always projects, you know.
No Doubt were back in business, ready to record a new album with the backing of Interscope, now on their offshoot, Trauma. However, frustrated by record company politics and disillusioned by his group's position, Eric left the band and threw the whole thing into disarray. He became, instead, a full-time animator on The Simpsons. As he'd been the primary songwriting force in the group, there seemed to be no future for No Doubt. But they took time out, considered their options, and decided to carry on to honour what he had helped build from scratch. Rather than let this be the final chapter for the band, Gwen was inspired to become herself the main songwriter. She was obsessed with making No Doubt as good as they could be, and ploughed herself into writing a ton of songs. Whereas Eric had previously written most of their lyrics, Gwen stepped into the fray with lyrics that penetrated the very core of her experiences. There were semi-autobiographical tales of everyday feminism in a man's world, just a girl, and relationship breakdown, Don't Speak. She was hitting her stride, revealing a perceptive intelligence and passionate creativity that placed her at the vanguard of contemporary female musicians. The third album, Tragic Kingdom, was released in October 1995 and attracted a slew of growing notices and reviews. It was assisted by the release of three smash hit singles, Just a Girl, Don't Speak, and Spiderwebs. Just a Girl is a rush of punky lyrics and defiant attitude conveying angst about the problems faced by women in a macho, male-dominated world. Featured in the film Clueless, Just a Girl steps in and expresses everything that had been locked inside of her, not to mention legions of teenage girls and young women the world over, for years. The lyrics, I'm just a girl, take a good look at me, just your typical prototype, oh, I've had it up to here, oh, am I making myself clear, are concise, razor sharp, and expertly delivered with a sassy, feisty rage. Spiderwebs and Don't Speak catapulted No Doubt into the big time. The latter single, an ode to Gwen's relationship with Tony Kanal, struck a chord with the public and topped the charts worldwide. Thanks to constant touring and the regular airplay of singles on MTV's Buzzbin, the album hit the top 10 in 1996 and went on to reach the Billboard top spot by the end of the year. It even garnered two Grammy nominations. Gwen, who had hardly made a secret of her pop star ambitions, became a centerpiece of attention as an alternative to the crop of tough girls dominating the airwaves and charts. The music and style press flocked to catch the lowdown on this new beguiling pop princess. Don't Speak became an anthem and a kind of modern-day standard, a ballad loved by many different tribes. It registered the band's name with a massive worldwide audience and established Gwen as a writer of rare delicacy, insight, and power. The Tragic Kingdom album is a spectacular achievement from a group still finding its first couple of gears career-wise. It is beautiful, poetic, fun, colourful, diverse, and very entertaining throughout. Featuring 14 killer cuts, ranging from Climb, 16 and You Can Do It, through to Hey You and Sunday Morning, it expertly straddles the dividing lines between third wave ska, new wave, and 90s pop, and constantly impresses with its melodic sensibility. Produced by Matthew Wilder, the one-hit wonder from the 80s responsible for Break My Stride, Tragic Kingdom is an appealing blend of West Coast sunshine, post-grunge rock, and pure melodic bliss. It oozes self-confidence and a choppy, polished, perfect pop sheen. Don't Speak is a heavenly distillation of every genius love song in rock and roll history. Spiderwebs is irrepressibly wonderful, and 16 stones the listener's soul. With a number 5 with Spiderwebs, a number 10 with Just a Girl, and with Don't Speak hitting the number 1 spot, No Doubt felt part of the pop firmament. The album reached double platinum sales status, shifting an astonishing 10 million copies. By the spring of 1997, Tragic Kingdom was happily ensconced at the top of album charts the world over, with a number 1 showing in the UK of February that year. There seemed no limits to what they could achieve. With Gwen's sex siren looks, her facility for penning magical hooks, and the group's almost telepathic chemistry threatening to rip up the rulebook, the future was theirs for the taking.
Player, and he's kind of the one that turned me on to a lot of music that I never really listened to in high school because I was so into ska music, but he was really into like Prince and The Time and Lisa Cult Jam and Club Nouveau and Debbie Deb, and so it was like I wanted to make a record that felt like those records made me feel, like those early Madonna records or you know, those Cyndi Lauper records, and just have that feeling of really melodic and really catchy and really kind of guilty pleasure.
In May and June of 1997, their 10th anniversary year, No Doubt recorded their first official video. Released in the fall, Live in the Tragic Kingdom is a superior set which would be later released on DVD. The guys started work on their fourth album with little inspiration, but Gwen flexed her creative muscles by branching out with other artists, namely Elvis Costello, Brian Setzer and Billy Idol, and appearing in films and television. She took parts in Dawson's Creek, Rage, Mad TV, Ellen, and the movies Go and the Rugrats movie. Snakes was used in Beavis and Butthead Do America, and Gwen collaborated with Moby on his song Southside. She coloured her hair blue and set about composing new material without the help of a producer. Eventually, the band hooked up with Glenn Ballard, the knob twiddler responsible for Alanis Morissette's records, and a period of writing and recording evolved. The first fruit of these sessions came in the form of New, which was used in the film Go. This proved to be a commercial failure, though, and no doubt set off on a small tour in the fall of 1999. The group's fourth disc, Return of Saturn, was issued in April 2000 and spawned the hits Ex-Girlfriend, Simple Kind of Life and Bathwater. It peaked at number 2 on the Billboard's chart and generated a series of gushing reviews. Meanwhile, Gwen's collaboration with Moby was released as a single and scaled number 12 in the singles charts. Return of Saturn is a scintillating set, encompassing a broad stylistic palette across its 14 deadly tracks. The time spent in the studio and writing has clearly honed their craft to perfection. For here are a cornucopia of sonic delights for all open-minded listeners. They present a cleaner, polished representation of their influences and inspirations. No doubt pull off some of the more difficult arcane manoeuvres of pure skanking reggae, pounding ska, punk attitude, and new wave rock and pop. Gwen, the Orange County Princess of the Pout, delivers a performance of sheer bravura on each distinguished cut, coming on like the missing link between Mae West and Susie Sue. Tunes like Bathwater and Ex-Girlfriend expose her heart on her sleeve, and the group's sense of humour and controlled power are more than a match for the song's sentiments. Simple Kind of Life follows on from where Don't Speak left off, an exquisite song poem about the end of a relationship that displays Gwen's psychological insight and keen sense of yearning in her songs. Another poignant first-person narrative, it is notable for the most touching of lines. I always thought I'd be a mom. Sometimes I wish for a mistake. The longer that I wait, the more selfish that I get. You seemed like you'd be a good dad. When faced with such disarming, self-lacerating honesty and sensitivity, the kind that gets under the skin and raises goosebumps on the arms, you're left with no other option than to surrender to such sumptuous grace. Bathwater is a slab of ska-happy joy. 6 Feet Under is laced with pure pop-punk noise. Magic's in the Makeup is a sublime existential essay on the price of fame and celebrity, positing the surely rhetorical question, if the magic's in the makeup, then who am I? And Artificial Sweetener files a report from the other side of the love-souring experience. Too Late, Comforting Lie, and Suspension Without Suspense are a trio of dense, heavy, emotional songs that take the themes of loneliness, lost, and unrequited love and weave searing, profound narratives that pierce the heart. Dark Blue is another magnificent, claustrophobic, grinding, pitch-black song of anguish and melancholy, tapping into the deepest recesses of love and loss. The guitar riffs are insanely catchy, and the beats are crazy, making for a hypnotic musical stew. Speaker-shattering punk rock, sultry ska and pure pop all compete with the saturnine, churning angst anthems and the prettiest love letters to create the perfect alternative pop album. No Doubt had confirmed their status as Premier League big hitters in contemporary rock and pop, and it seemed they were on an unassailable ascent.
Club Nouveau song, and that's what ticked me off. I was like, God, I want to make a dance record, you know? I want to sing Rumors, you know? So I went and tried to get the people that were kind of in the club today, like the Neptunes and Dre and Andre, and I was like, hey, you want to write a song? And here we are.
At the beginning of 2001, No Doubt retreated to the studio to work on their fifth album, which they promised would contain traces of Jamaican dancehall influences, And in April, they flew to Jamaica to soak up the ragga dancehall flavours. Meanwhile, Gwen recorded a song with the rapper Eve called Let Me Blow Your Mind, which got a release as a single in the fall. It became the biggest hit on Eve's album and charted all around the world, including a number 4 in the UK and 3 on the Billboard chart. In December 2001, No Doubt returned to the spotlight with the excellent Rocksteady album. Released a mere 18 months after their previous effort, it marks a departure from the trademark No Doubt style. Preceded by a smash hit in Hey Baby, a staple on radio and MTV and VH1, Rocksteady sees the group usher Jamaican dancehall and slamming hip-hop beats into their mix. The list of collaborators involved reads like a stellar cast of talisman and facilitators, from Dave Stewart and Nellie Hooper to The Cars' Rick Ocasek and even Prince. The album is a dazzling, kaleidoscopic, widescreen production encompassing out-and-out pop on Making Out, 80s new wave on Don't Let Me Down, booming dancehall on Start the Fire, and rock on Platinum Blonde Life. The arrangements are subtle, and the playing is remarkable. Lyrically, Gwen continues her fixation with the dynamics of sexual relationships to even greater effect. In February 2002, Hey Baby peaked at 2 in the British Singles Chart, and Gwen won her first Grammy Award for her collaboration with Eve. Meanwhile, she and Gavin got engaged in January and tied the knot at a ceremony at St Paul's Church in London in September. She got married in a white dress designed by John Galliano. Rocksteady went double platinum, and the Hella Good single peaked at number 12 on the UK Singles Chart and 13 on Billboard. In October, Underneath It All reached 18 in the UK and number 3 in the US, which made it 6 top 10 hits for Gwen. Also in October, a special edition of Rocksteady was released, including a bonus CD of 7 tracks. In the fall, No Doubt completed a successful tour behind Rocksteady, which was when Gwen stumbled upon the idea of making her own solo record. She happened to hear a snippet of an old Club Nouveau song she loved as a high school teenager, Why You Treat Me So Bad, and was transported back in a reverie to high school dances at Knott's Berry Farm in Buena Park, California. She had the idea of making a genre-bending record featuring a gallery of iconic producers and collaborators, a landmark pop album that would transcend barriers and categories. In the meantime, her status as a sex siren of the 21st century was underlined by her being ranked at number 22 in Stuff magazine's 102 Sexiest Women in the World.
Saturn and that whole record, it was such a really weird transitional phase for me, that whole period of my life. And I think fashion wise it really looks like it, you know. I have like the pink hair, and I see it with a lot of the younger artists, is they just feel like they have to outdo every single thing that they did before. And I think during Return to Saturn I was very confused, trying to find like some new look to outdo whatever I'd done.
By 2003, No Doubt had reached the stature of elder statesmen and women of alternative rock and pop, so a greatest hits compilation was long overdue. Discussions took place amongst the band over which tracks would make the final cut, and they also agreed to record new material for the best of. At the Grammy Awards ceremony, No Doubt won an award for Best Pop Single for Hey Baby, and the band cut a storming version of the classic 1984 single by Talk Talk, It's My Life. This cover was the subject of much disagreement between No Doubt and Nellie Hooper regarding whether or not to release it as a single and on the compilation. Nellie had the last word and was proved right. Released in November 2003, It's My Life won an army of admirers with its infectious, sleek updating of one of the best singles of the 1980s. The single went top 10 on both sides of the Atlantic and helped shift more than 250,000 copies of the Best Of compilation, entitled Singles 1992 to 2003, in the first week of release. It also won an MTV Music Video Award. This pristine collection included 15 of the obvious contenders, from Just a Girl, Trapped in a Box and Bathwater, through to Simple Kind of Life and Spiderwebs, and even came with two bonus tracks, an acoustic version of Underneath It All and a mix of Hey Baby. It is an awesome compilation of their finest moments, featuring some of the catchiest pop of the previous decade. Brilliant music, inspirational lyrics, soul-searching vocals, it has the whole package. In tandem, No Doubt also released a box set on the same day in November, an ensemble that accommodated the singles collection, a DVD of music videos, and a DVD version of the earlier Live in the Tragic Kingdom set. They also planned to release Rocksteady Live, a DVD of a show taped at Long Beach Arena on the Rocksteady tour. Gwen's other side interests continued to captivate her adoring public, and she set up her own fashion label called LAMB in the spring of 2004. Her range of clothes and bags generated much publicity and soon attracted the patronage of the world's most glamorous celebrities, including the likes of Paris Hilton, Carmen Electra, and Halle Berry. She was also voted one of People magazine's 50 Most Beautiful People of 2004. Never ones to rest on their laurels and kick off their shoes and socks, the band released a special compilation of B-sides, oddities and obscurities entitled Everything in Time, B-Sides Rarities Remixes in October 2004. The 17-song collection contained little gems like Cellophane Boy, New Friend and the collaborations with Elvis Costello and Ms. Dynamite.
The press for me is not real. You know, that's a bunch of words that I don't even, you know, if I started paying attention to that, I don't know if I could actually, I'd be in a mental institution.
Gwen's acting career took a step forward when she nabbed roles in The Aviator and 51st Dates in 2004. But this year was most notable for her blossoming as a solo musical artist. Unveiled in November, the 12-track monster known as Love Angel Music Baby received acres of coverage in the press, all of it highly complimentary. Here was an artist going it alone in the right way, spreading her wings, opening her mind to a dizzying range of possibilities. The genius of this album lies in the lack of ego of the central performer. For her solo debut, Gwen so easily could have gone it totally alone, locked herself away from the world, and come up with a generic dollop of sub-Alanis female singer-songwriter shtick, and secretly, many might have expected it. Instead, Gwen has roped in a host of credible, sensitive, creative collaborators, geared to making fresh, soulful, life-affirming dance floor dynamite. Dr. Dre, The Neptunes, Eve, Andre 3000, Nelly Hooper, Jam and Lewis, Linda Perry, and Dallas Austin. With credentials like that, the album always had a chance of succeeding, but too often in such cases the clash of egos render the project a vacuous, flabby vanity project. Not in this case, for each of these gifted talents have harnessed their creativity to produce some majestic music. It's free-flowing, powerful, incandescent and flamboyant in the right sense. The whole album is an irresistible party, trashy, hedonistic and deeply weird at times. There's no buttock-clenching designer existentialist angst, no one-dimensional grooves on autopilot, no inane posturing, just a smart, sassy, uplifting concoction of dance floor poetry. And anyone who can persuade New Order to appear on the same song as Wendy and Lisa must have something special. Gwen's gum-snapping sass brings out the beast in her technicians and beatheads, particularly the Neptunes on Hollaback Girl and Andre 3000 on Bubble Pop Electric. And her performances are truly extraordinary, revelatory, and perfectly judged. She's clearly put a lot into this elegiac, lyrical celebration of an album. And despite the obsessive fan credentials, this comes across as more about seduction than banner waving. She sieves the hedonistic dance floor vibe through a series of pervasive and penetrating vignettes from her producers' sources, bands, and singers, and they stretch the limits of imagination. Love Angel Music Baby is a kind of jive-ass roadshow that doesn't care if it sounds out of control. You can hear marvelous beats, soaring vocals, stabbing horns, and the most invigorating songs this side of Chic's catalogue, all within a magnificently sprawling framework. This is dance floor pop with a timeless modern feel, a future classic. It is 21st century state-of-the-art pop. Here, She Wants It All, Vivienne Westwood and John Galliano, Backseat Love and Lifetime Devotion, 70s pop throwbacks and hip-hop beats as well as clash adulation. Among the standouts are the feminist anthem, What You Waiting For, a true match for Cyndi Lauper's Girls Just Wanna Have Fun, the tongue firmly in cheek Eve and Dr. Dre collaboration, Rich Girl, the Madonna sound-alike, The Real Thing, and the Tony Basil referencing, Hollaback Girl. This is explosive, joyful stuff, dripping with sweat, sex, and celebration of life. What You Waiting For was released as a single in November 2004 and immediately made its presence felt in the top 10, while the album sold 500,000 in its first 2 weeks. At the beginning of 2005, No Doubt got together with luminaries such as Elton John, Rod Stewart, Velvet Revolver, Pink, and Ozzy and Sharon Osbourne to record a cover of Eric Clapton's Tears in Heaven for the Tsunami Disaster Fund. They also played at a Tsunami benefit concert in February. At the Grammy ceremony in February, Gwen performed What You Waiting For and was nominated for a Best Female Pop Performance Grammy. No Doubt were also nominated for It's My Life for Best Pop Performance by Duo or Group. In addition, Gwen picked up a Best International Female Artist Award at the Brits, where she also performed What You Waiting For. In March, Gwen released Rich Girl, an irreverent reinvention of If I Were a Rich Man from Fiddler on the Roof as her new single.
Certain songs you have to get approved samples, you know, so he came to me with the idea, but then it was this whole thing like, well, we don't know if we're going to be able to get approval from the Fiddler on the Roof people, you know, and this whole thing, and I ended up like panicking, like, what am I going to make this about? I got to write the verses, you know, and I ended up going to see the musical on Broadway just to get inspired.
So who is the real Gwen Stefani, behind the piercing, the outrageous fashion sense, the bullish independence, the feminist rants, the raw sexuality? What is it that drives her on? In person, she is a charming, sweet, sincere individual who enjoys her success and appreciates what she's got. However, she has voiced her concerns about her biological clock ticking away as she reaches her middle 30s. The TikTok chorus on her single, What You Waiting For, apes the sound of her intense baby lust. She worries about the conflict of career and family, hoping that she'll have time to have children before it's too late. She argues that she can write songs anytime, but she won't always be able to conceive. She has mused, for example, that she would like to dress up in an Alice in Wonderland or Cinderella costume for her children when they come home from school every day. This is a typically bizarre comment from a woman who's always defined herself on the margins of orthodoxy, whether it be musical or otherwise. The Stefani clan are still a tight-knit bunch and live quite near each other. Gwen is extremely close to her sister Jill, whom she simply calls Sister, and she still maintains close links with Eric, whom she idolized as a teenager. For the near future, Gwen aims to hone her craft and artistry to their zenith, so she can look back and be satisfied that she gave music her biggest shot. She's put off thinking about the future for now and wants to live in the present. She loves her husband and her stepdaughter Daisy and won't waste any time worrying about what might happen in 5 or 10 years. Musically, her chief influences were derived from the 1980s and from British rock and pop. The whole two-tone movement of the late 70s and 80s, Selector, Madness, The Specials, had the biggest impact upon her as an adolescent. This quirky, interracial hybrid sound paved the way for her own explorations of the common ground between punk, new wave, ska, and Jamaican reggae. Prince and his entourage of musical talent proved equally influential upon the young Gwen. The Paisley Park sound he invented was a fresh, radical take on the black pop and R&B music that had come before. Pure pop has always informed Gwen's sensibility, and noisy, bratish guitar rock, punk, new wave or grunge, is never far from her listening palette. Hip-hop, dancehall and electronica have made their presence felt on recent No Doubt efforts, and significantly so on her own debut album. Collaborating with Eve and Bounty Killer has helped introduce her to a new type of audience, in the same way that Texas, linking up with the Wu-Tang Clan, benefited both parties. Lately, she's been impressed by the Keane album, Hopes and Fears, and has raised the possibility of working with them. Gwen has always been a staunch feminist, a person who sees through hypocrisy, injustice, and discrimination, and just wants a decent, fair stab at realizing her dreams and ambitions. She isn't, of course, a dour, humorless automaton, but a multi-dimensional woman who is at home discussing clothes as much as she is pricking other people's consciences. She is a flawed, colourful, compelling personality.
To use certain songs, you have to get approved samples, you know. So he came to me with the idea, but then it was this whole thing like, well, we don't know if we're going to be able to get approval from the Fiddler on the Roof people, you know, and this whole thing. And I ended up, like, panicking, like, what am I going to make this about? I got to write the verses, you know. And I ended up going to see the musical on Broadway just to get inspired.
So who is the real Gwen Stefani, behind the piercing, the outrageous fashion sense, the bullish independence, the feminist rants, the raw sexuality? What is it that drives her on? In person, she is a charming, sweet, sincere individual who enjoys her success and appreciates what she's got. However, she has voiced her concerns about her biological clock ticking away as she reaches her middle 30s. The TikTok chorus on her single, What You Waiting For, apes the sound of her intense baby lust. She worries about the conflict of career and family, hoping that she'll have time to have children before it's too late. She argues that she can write songs anytime, but she won't always be able to conceive. She has mused, for example, that she would like to dress up in an Alice in Wonderland or Cinderella costume for her children when they come home from school every day. This is a typically bizarre comment from a woman who's always defined herself on the margins of orthodoxy, whether it be musical or otherwise. The Stefani clan are still a tight-knit bunch and live quite near each other. Gwen is extremely close to her sister Jill, whom she simply calls Sister, and she still maintains close links with Eric, whom she idolized as a teenager. For the near future, Gwen aims to hone her craft and artistry to their zenith, so she can look back and be satisfied that she gave music her biggest shot. She's put off thinking about the future for now and wants to live in the present. She loves her husband and her stepdaughter Daisy and won't waste any time worrying about what might happen in 5 or 10 years. Musically, her chief influences were derived from the 1980s and from British rock and pop. The whole two-tone movement of the late 70s and 80s, Selector, Madness, The Specials, had the biggest impact upon her as an adolescent. This quirky, interracial hybrid sound paved the way for her own explorations of the common ground between punk, new wave, ska, and Jamaican reggae. Prince and his entourage of musical talent proved equally influential upon the young Gwen. The Paisley Park sound he invented was a fresh, radical take on the black pop and R&B music that had come before. Pure pop has always informed Gwen's sensibility, and noisy, bratish guitar rock, punk, new wave or grunge, is never far from her listening palette. Hip-hop, dancehall and electronica have made their presence felt on recent No Doubt efforts, and significantly so on her own debut album. Collaborating with Eve and Bounty Killer has helped introduce her to a new type of audience, in the same way that Texas, linking up with the Wu-Tang Clan, benefited both parties. Lately, she's been impressed by the Keane album, Hopes and Fears, and has raised the possibility of working with them. Gwen has always been a staunch feminist, a person who sees through hypocrisy, injustice, and discrimination, and just wants a decent, fair stab at realizing her dreams and ambitions. She isn't, of course, a dour, humorless automaton, but a multi-dimensional woman who is at home discussing clothes as much as she is pricking other people's consciences. She is a flawed, colourful, compelling personality.
Really weird. It's like for the first time in a while, like I said, because I've been chasing the future so much lately, I just don't even know what's going to happen next. I mean, the one good thing about taking a break and working with all these other people and getting outside of the comfort zone of the No Doubt family is that it sounds very appealing to me to like go back into that little nest and be like, hey, flirt around about writing some songs, you know?
Gwen Stefani is a dazzling protean talent, an artist whose records are so crammed full of ideas and riffs and crazy bits that you keep coming back for more. She has no other obvious rival on the alternative scene. She has the charisma and sass of Madonna, but her music is infinitely more interesting, challenging, and soulful. Having conquered the world with No Doubt's thrilling loose-limbed take on Grotty Scar New Wave, she has exploded everybody's conception of Gwen Stefani with the success of her solo album. There really wasn't very much within the No Doubt releases to suggest that she'd take it this far. A massive step forward from the No Doubt songbook, her debut solo project takes the listener on a dizzy, free association ride through the maze of black dance culture, a kaleidoscope of images and sonic bricolage that leaves other female artists trailing in its dust. As an album, it is delirious with its creative possibilities, with the sheer strangeness of sound, with the juxtaposing of different elements and producers. It all sounds perfectly natural, unforced and organic, a confluence of dance floor styles in bizarre collusion. It spins through the kind of images evoked by one of those classic all-over-the-place Walkman compilations people used to make before the advent of iPods. A lightning tour of the best of dance floor culture, utilizing the wanna-be-there storytelling that conjures up happy, sad America. Gwen is so gifted, versatile, strong-willed and independent that there is no limit to what she can hope to achieve in her career. She exudes a swaggering self-belief and an artistry that places her in an altogether different stratosphere to the legions of whingers such as Alanis and Avril, who mistake self-loathing for eloquence. She possesses a sense of urgency and a creativity that indicates she wants to be remembered as an all-time great in the musical pantheon. She is nobody's puppet and has never acted against her best artistic instincts. She transcends facile categories such as rock, pop, dance, or ska fusion, and she uses whatever resources appear to suit the song in question. Her best sounds reaffirm one's faith in music and life itself, providing succor to the lost, the dismayed, and the confused. It's a touching fiction that comes as an unexpected warmth, a curious lifting of the spirits. Even an ignorant slob knows out-and-out brilliance when he hears it, and her records often hit that spot. At times, listening to them, you feel like the person who has, out of nowhere, been presented with an armful of gilded lilies. She throws in everything, including the kitchen sink, making grandiloquent declarations of intent with pulsating, passionate beats and plangent chords. Her music gallops on relentlessly, in pursuit of the perfect pop moment, glistening with melody, sexiness, and visceral thrills, usually associated with a snarling attack of punk, or the defiant hedonism of the best disco and house. For all its opulence, playfulness, kitsch irony, and celebratory tone, the solo album is a deeply melancholy record, hankering after a romantic pop perfection that tantalizes all our imaginations but can never be grasped more than fleetingly. Gwen has always written well on that most important and universal of subjects, namely romantic love. Whether it be the giddy rush of lust, acceptance of deep affection into your heart, or the sorrow and misery of unrequited love. Many of her finest moments deal expertly with lost love and delineate the exact areas of fissure with unerring accuracy and compassion. Gwen is well and truly an icon for our times, seemingly distant, rarefied and elusive, yet simultaneously beautifully flawed. She is as comfortable with sociopolitics as she is with fashion and sex, and can display different facets of her character according to the context and situation. She's forthright, candid, and speaks about issues, personal or those of wider significance, with a clarity and intelligence fitting for an unofficial spokesperson for a generation. Gwen is a soulful, incandescent spirit, a restless talent who thrives on flux, change, and new challenges. She has the vigour and energy to combine a solo career with no doubt, a film career with her family, and a fashion empire with her celebrity status. She dislikes stasis and creative repetition, preferring to seek out new territories and test herself in different environments and settings. There would be few raised eyebrows if she announced a desire to run for office, for instance, or enter literature or journalism. She's forever kicking against boundaries, pushing back the barriers, and introducing new components to her musical education. She's wisely stayed ahead of the game and coolly absorbed a wealth of influences from different areas of music as she's matured and experimented with sound. The ska and punky new wave pop that characterized her formative experiences and her early No Doubt records have been joined by a thrilling mix of modern styles that help keep her abreast of contemporary trends and ensure her music never goes stale. The best of her songs accumulate resonance as the time falls away. The chiming guitars, jerky rhythms, and guttural vocals add up to music that enjoys the rare distinction of not sounding like anyone but Gwen Stefani. What will make her special to posterity is the same thing that makes her difficult to pigeonhole today. She's never really had the following wind of a movement of any kind to lend her mystique. She doesn't stand for anything but herself. She is a one-woman genre, literally in a class of her own. Her finest songs embody a rich vein of sympathy for human behaviour and a spirit that will endure for years to come. To describe someone by their contradictions may be a cliché, but here is a vibrant, intense young woman shimmering with contrasts. To seem simultaneously one of us, and then to be regally aloof, to be self-possessed and serious for one song, and then girlishly silly during the next, to appear otherworldly, driven, and wise beyond her years, while seeming lost, vulnerable, guileless, and naive. These are golden qualities for this most outlandish of stars, and they all shine from the girl with the unspoken angst behind the flashing eyes, the icy stare, and the impeccable attire. Here is a remarkable woman, a stunning artist, a mercurial poet all rolled into one. She seems destined to attain all-time great status. Where she goes from here is an interesting question to raise. Will she juggle music with acting and fashion? Will she carve out a parallel solo career, or will she disband No Doubt? Will she even set up her own music empire, cultivating young talent for her own record label? Will she head into PR or management? What about a putative career in politics or administration? Or maybe she'll just shun the glare of the media spotlight and bring up her family, act upon that ticking clock. It's evident that she's capable of achieving anything if she puts her mind to it, so it would be no surprise if she had a stab at all of the above. This special, highly unusual, multifaceted individual already has altered the landscape of popular culture for the better, and there seems no reason to believe she won't carry on twisting it into new and exciting shapes for many years to come. Gwen Stefani has lived a charmed existence so far and possesses all the tools to mark out a status as the 21st century Madonna, if she so wishes. Keenly competitive, soulful, positive, emotional, and fiercely intelligent, she remains one of the greatest female icons of our age.
Thank you for playing Maximum Gwen Stefani. We hope you enjoyed it. Watch out for further titles on Chrome Dreams coming up soon. If you did enjoy it or have any comments or suggestions, write to us at Chrome Dreams, P.O. Box 230, New Malden, Surrey, UK, KT36YY, or email on mail@chromedreams.co.uk. Details of our full catalogue are listed on our website at www.chromedreams.co.uk. Thanks again for listening, and goodbye for now.